Hey everybody, Clay Archer, CEO of DBC Technology. I've got a good one today. Today we're going to check out the Unifi UDM Pro Max. So a lot of you have probably been seeing the UDM Pro Max being teased over the last few weeks. I've been really lucky. Unifi sent me a pre-release, two pre-release units so that I could test it out. So I'm not being paid for this review, but they did send me the units. I appreciate that. And all the opinions in this review are my own. But I want to go over the quick headliners of this unit. I want to show you a couple of the cool new features. And then I'm going to talk about who this unit is for. First of all, the big headliner for me is the price, $599. But before we get into that, let's take a look at what this unit has that's different than other units. So first of all, with the new OS 4.0, you're able to use true shadow mode. So if one unit fails, the other one is able to just take over and run in its place. That's an awesome continuity feature. Second, it has a 2.5 gigabit WAN interface, which is awesome for those with high-speed connections. Third, and probably the most important for it is twice the processing power of the previous units, meaning you are going to be able to add a ton of devices to this unit. With full DPI and IPS security enabled, it can route at 4.3 gigabit per second versus the 3.5 for the UDM Pro and the UDM SE. So what does that mean for you? At the end of the day, this is really just a super powerful UDM Pro or UDM SE. This is designed to run a ton of devices across a large infrastructure, maybe a remote multiple site locations, and across the entire application suite. And the fourth kind of obvious upgrade here is that you have two drives for redundancy on your Protect installation. Before I jump into those features and kind of talk about the use case scenarios and who I think this device is for, let's take a look at the real party trick of this system. And we'll look at shadow mode with automatic failover. So real quick, let's jump into the software here. It's super easy to set this up, and I was amazed how easy it was to get this going. First of all, before I set up anything, I actually just started with a fresh clean install on the first UDM Pro Max. All the same interface, everything looks the same. Obviously we have some new features. I'm not gonna go into every new feature of 8.0. I'm not gonna go into every new feature of 4.0 on the firmware. But for the most part, if you've used the UDM Pro or you've used the UDM SE, everything's gonna look the same to you. It's very easy, it's very intuitive. Set it up just like normal. So once I had that all set up, all I had to do was plug the WAN port on the secondary UDM Pro Max into any of the LAN ports on the first UDM Pro Max. As soon as you do that, the primary UDM Pro Max sees it and says, do you wish to set it to shadow mode? You just click the button and a few minutes later, it goes through it and it syncs. Probably took 5 minutes, super easy, no big deal. So that's what we've seen to this point before with shadow mode. But now we go to the new part that we get in 4.0. Let me also say that this is alpha software that we're testing on here. I had zero bugs, zero glitches, zero anything, but it may be a little different in the early release or release software that you see. So what you did once you had that synced is you clicked the little button that said enable automatic failover, and then it kind of walks you through this four-step process. First, it warns you if you have anything plugged into port 7 on either of the units to remove that, and then you plug a cable from one to the other on both of their port 7s. So once you plug them together and you click next, it sets up the high availability cluster, which is step 2. It takes maybe 2 or 3 minutes to do that. Maybe it was more than that, maybe it was less than that, but it wasn't very long. And then basically once you're done with that, it prompts you to remove the WAN cable that you had on the secondary connected to the LAN on the primary, and then to plug in a secondary internet into the WAN port on the second device. The third step and the last step is to plug them both into your network, and boom, it's done. It's so easy, it's so quick, and it may sound complicated, but you just basically follow the instructions on the screen. It took less than 10 minutes, and it's set up. And now, what's awesome is if either of them fail, the other one just takes over, and it's seamless. It works really well. I'm really impressed with this. You know, how many people and their home labs need this, I don't know. That's maybe a little bit over the scope of a home lab. But if this is a high availability setup that maybe you put in a data center to control multiple sites, you won't have to worry about that. Having multiple WAN connections means that you have failover there. It really is pretty impressive the way they've done this. So is that a home use case? Probably not, unless you're an Uber nerd like me. But the reality of it is in 4.0, it does work. It's now seamless. It's all that we thought that could be. Future Clay here. I just wanted to go back and cover a couple things real quick. One, the two hard drives that are in the unit. If you have two hard drives in each of the two units and the first one fails over to the second one, it would just start recording on the second drives in the second unit. You would have to export those videos or see those videos from that individual unit. So you have that redundancy of those two units, which which may not be perfect, but you would have no gap in the recording cut. I mean, obviously you'd have a cutover gap there. You'd have one clip in and another in start, but that would be, you know, seconds there. But if you wanted to use the same set of drives, you could not have drives in the secondary unit and then remove the drives from the primary unit, put them in the secondary unit, have that one run, and if you ever switched them back, switch them back again. That would keep the recordings all on those two drives. I think most people would opt for option A, where you have two drives in each of the two units. You know, when you switch over, you would have to go to that unit to see those images. But you have the option either way you want to do there. Obviously, it doesn't record to both sets of drives all the time there on Protect. You know, just to clarify how that would work in the case of failover. If you had them in both drives, you would have no gap in coverage. But if you had them in just one of the UDMs, it would only record to that one. So, but they are both, redundant. They're both mirrored so for each unit. So if one drive fails in either unit, you'd be fine. Also, I didn't quite cover the power supply redundancy that you have here. If you have a USP RPS, you will be able to have a power supply failure in either of these units and just have it keep running. That's just another fault tolerance, another redundancy item built into this unit. And then that brings me to support, which is a question I got a ton of in the forums about. And I think this is where Unifi is really making a big push in this direction. You saw lately that Unifi is now offering a support option. And I think that support option is probably going to roll over to managed service providers. So obviously, if you're going to put, you know, multi-thousands of devices on the site and put it in a data center somewhere, you're going to want to be able to pick up the phone and call somebody. And so I think Unifi is working really hard to make that be a reality. They've already rolled that service out in the USA and Canada, and I think you're going to see that service roll out in further countries throughout the world. So 24-hour, 365 technical support is obviously what you're going to need if you're going to offer this as a managed service provider. So with that, let's jump back into the video. That brings me back to kind of who is this device for? You know, the high-speed WAN, failover, the more processing power. I mean, I don't know that a lot of people that are using a UDM SE at home are going, man, I wish I had more processing power, because you're probably only running, you know, a couple hundred devices, maybe less, probably 50 devices in your home. But if you get to the spots where, you know, an enterprise level equipment is probably not necessary, but you are running multiple hundreds of devices over multiple locations, I think that's where this device is kind of headed. So who is this device for? And is it for you? Well, you know, obviously, you know, the biggest questions I think that you're going to get out there, at least what I saw online was, hey, there's no ether lighting, there's no 2.5 gig LAN or 10 gig LAN, or there's no PoE on the LAN. I think this device is not intended for anybody that would have the need for those in 8 ports. So, you know, the people that are going to buy this are going to already have switching, already going to have PoE. They're already going to have those things. The reason that they went with some redundancy on the hard drives in the front of it, typically, you know, you're going to be running 10, 15, you know, more cameras than 8 ports we're ever going to use. So putting PoE on it, or putting 2.5, or putting, you know, whatever you're going to put there, was probably overkill. Most people are going to connect this over 10 gig SFP plus to another switch. So I think they chose not to put that level of switching in it, just to save cost there. And that brings me back to their $599 price. I think this device is starting to step into the MSP space. You know, this is going to be an organization that's got a ton of devices. They want the security features of a higher-end firewall, but maybe they're not ready to take a step into like a Meraki or a SonicWall. You name one of the other channel partner devices there. And at $599, I think there is definitely going to be a use case where this works well. Obviously, you're going to get the rapid V2VN deployment. You're going to get single sign-on if you're going to use something like UID. I think that is the market they're going for. And I think that this is going to be a pretty successful device in that market. I also think the high-end home enthusiast that just wants the best, fastest, that may have some need for 2.5 gigabit internet, I do think the Uber nerd, aka me, will have this, you know, $599 versus $499. Hey, just give me all the bells and whistles. I've already got the switching. I don't need that stuff. And, you know, that begs the question of how is Unifi going to get in that space? You know, I can see that they're putting more emphasis into Unifi Site Manager, which is great, because I have a feeling if you're going in that space that you're going to want to be able to deploy these devices really quickly from single pane of glass. There's a joke at DPC Technology, we're MSP. Whenever somebody says single pane of glass, you have to drink. But I do feel like Unifi is in a unique position where their interface looks good. And I think it's really easy for people to adopt. I think the end user that sees the other end of the interface likes the way that Unifi stuff looks. So I think there's a big uptick there. I was watching a Tom Lawrence podcast. Shout out to Tom. I'm sure he's doing a review of this. But the big cost for an MSP to deploy something like this is the usability and the training and the ease of use for both your staff and for the end user. And I think Unifi is in a unique position where if they can get a lot of these pieces in line, they could make some real waves in the community. That being said, there's a ways to go. You know, I think this is a step in the right direction. Some more global management stuff would be great. A lot of the, you know, I put it up in the MSP forums. A lot of the MSPs were worried about security. Honestly, over the last 12 to 24 months, I think they've made huge strides on their security. I think they've made huge strides on the VPN. They're coming out with updates to the OS, to Unifi Network, to Unifi Protect, like on a weekly, monthly basis now. And they're big updates, and they're doing it rapidly. So I think there's some momentum behind it. Are they there yet? I don't know. I don't think that they're quite there yet. I'm not ready to jump ship and put all of my clients on there. Obviously, if you're, you know, in the healthcare or you know, you have some high regulatory requirements, you're going to be really cautious making that move. But I do think that somebody that, you know, if you're doing IT for a big landscape company and they want to put in a couple of these to run all their locations, I think this is going to be a device that's going to end up being in the use in those locations quite a bit. Ultimately, for me, I'm probably going to throw this up into our data center, put a couple of WAN connections to it, redundant power to it. It'll be a big, huge cloud controller. It can run multiple sites. I think there's something to be said for kind of the broad spectrum of how this is going to be used. And I'm really interested to see where Ubiquiti takes this going forward. A lot of the feedback I got in the forums was about availability. It seems like the latest, greatest stuff from Unifi has been hard to get. But I haven't felt the same about wireless access points and switches. Obviously, if you're trying to get them the first day they come out, that's been difficult. You know, we put a ton of these products, especially switches and WAPs, in our clients' offices, and we don't really have that much of trouble with getting them. But that is something that Unifi is going to have to address with the MSP community if they're going to go direct. But there is a huge pro to Unifi in that they have not gone to a subscription model on pretty much anything, which, you know, that's a dual-edged sword. But, you know, what you're getting for a one-time fee, $5.99 for a router with this capability is pretty amazing. If you were in a Meraki or a SonicWall or insert name here, it would be, you know, double that, triple that, maybe four times that. So those are huge advantages for Unifi. I think there needs to be some more development in this path. I'm really excited about where it's headed. The other thing about the price of this and not having the subscription model, if you took that monthly subscription that you were paying to those other vendors and you put it into endpoint stuff like, you know, EDR or MDR or SIM or you know, that kind of stuff, I think that may be a better use of those funds and ultimately probably offer more protection. I digress there. I mean, everybody's got their own opinion there, but I definitely think that that's something worth considering or at least having the discussion about. So anyways, if you have any comments, I'm sure you will, please put them in the comments down below. If you want me to test anything else out with this unit, I mean, I barely scratched the surface. I'm sure there's going to be a bunch of YouTube videos on this. And if you have any comments about unifying the MSP space, I think that's a really interesting conversation. I think that the space could use a provider like Unifi. Please like and subscribe. We also have an affiliate link down below if you want to purchase one of these units. We'd love you to use that. Definitely helps out the channel. Thank you for Unifi again for sending the units. If you like videos like this, we do them weekly, and we'll see you guys in the next video.